mentioned earlier, we're on location at Weyerbacher, and we have Natalie and Kristen here with us, and we're very excited to be here, and the beers are just, they're screaming at me in a good way. They want me to drink them all. and we have a huge spread of beers that I'm sure we're going to get to, but now we want to get to know you guys again. So you guys were on before. Natalie, of course, you were with Weyerbacher then, but we met with you at the Humeville Inn. Before an aliens meeting, and Christian, you were on when you were with Golden Avalanche.
Correct.
It was snowing that day.
In fact, that day, the Golden Avalanche growler you brought, that was my first growler I ever owned.
So, oh, wow.
Thank you for that. You started...
You broke his growler, Terry.
Yes.
Put it to good use.
Yeah. Oh, it's sitting on a shelf in proud display.
Okay.
I haven't got any growlers filled in a while, so don't worry.
Fair enough.
Yeah. But even so, I'm so far away from Golden Avalanche. But we're here at Weyerbacher anyway, so that's a different story for
Let's talk about the brewery we're at.
Yes.
That's okay. We're all friends.
Yeah. So I when I found out we were going to be recording here, I looked up where you guys were located. And I knew Easton was an area, but I didn't know it was right before the New York border. So that kind of got
me. Or New Jersey border.
New Jersey? Is it Jersey?
Yeah, it's like right on the edge.
That's Jersey.
That's
New
Jersey?
Further north.
Oh, yeah. I saw signs for New York City, and then I saw last exit in PA. That's all I got.
Oh, you came out in 78?
Okay. Yeah, right. I did.
So
yep.
You, yep. No, we border New Jersey. We're directly across the Delaware River from Phillipsburg, New Jersey.
Okay. I just got a geography lesson. All right.
New York would be north.
Jersey is east. Yes.
Yeah.
And speaking of New Jersey,
you know,
you're the
Philly
New Jersey.
People, you got to take them out of Philly, and they're like,
I really don't know anything outside Philly.
Easton. Where is that in eastern PA? No, Easton. And then you get to Eastern, it's really just a clusterfuck.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
But now, you guys are, I didn't get the VIP tour because I showed up a little bit late, but now, how the facility that you guys have here, how big is that?
Well, this building, I think, is somewhere maybe 15 to 20,000 square feet, but we also have one or two other buildings for storage purposes, so that'll add at least another 10, probably.
Cool. Yeah, you missed the VIP tour, but it's funny because from the outside you wouldn't think this place is big.
And I'm not sure if you guys saw the other buildings. You're not missing much in there, but
right.
We saw the other buildings.
We were on an unsuccessful mission.
Yeah.
Okay.
We were looking for this year's reserve.
We didn't find it. Yeah. But we wandered, you know, all different, and it's like there's more space here. There's more other stuff over here. It's like a TARDIS. It's bigger on the inside.
Yep. Right. Yep.
We didn't see the warm room, but we saw the storage room over there. Didn't see the warm room. Saw the new space where the new brew house is going to be.
Yep.
Showed them that. So.
Yep.
So aside from the size of the building, what's the size of the system?
That was my next question.
Well, right now we have a hybrid system. We have a 20-barrel mash tun, 20-barrel louder tun, 20-barrel wort receiver, a 40-barrel boil kettle, and a 40-barrel whirlpool.
Nice. That's a lot of beer.
Yeah.
Now, I know we also saw an area. I'm sorry, Dan. I don't mean to. But I was on the VIP tour and you weren't.
I know. You are far more VIP than I.
some new equipment is going in. We saw an area where there's some work being done. So what's being added in there?
That will be our new brew house.
Okay.
That will be 40 barrels all around. It'll make life so much easier for us.
Yeah.
Because right now it's 2 to 3 mashes per 40 barrels. And most of our tanks are 80 barrels. So... you could have 6 mashes to fill 1 tank.
Right.
Wow.
With our new system, it's 2 mashes.
Right.
So it's a lot more efficient. It's going to save us time, malt. It's going to be great.
How many brews do you guys do in a day?
We do about 2 to 3, depending on the season, typically 3 40-barrel batches, so about 120 barrels a day, 5 days a week.
That's a lot of beer.
It really is.
And so when is that expected to be up and running then?
We are shooting for mid-November.
Soon.
Fingers crossed.
Soon. Fingers crossed.
I'm getting air quotes on the soon.
Yeah.
Not soon enough.
But sooner than later. Mm-hmm. Things are, all of our permits are good to go, so things will be moving quickly now.
Very cool.
Very nice.
So, Natalie, the last time you were on the show was episode 20, and now it's episode 40.
Ooh, congrats to you guys.
Oh, thanks.
You only come in multiples of 20, apparently. Yes. So, what's been new? What's been
so,
new?
In six more months, I will see you again.
What's new with the Weyerbacher beer rep world, and what's going on in New Jersey since we've seen you last?
Well, it's winter
which
ale season.
Which is to the east.
Because
which is to the,
which is to the east. Well, it's winter ale season since, obviously, it's just turned to fall. No. We're smack dab in the middle of pumpkin ale season, even though we've been selling it. Yes, since the summer. But, you know, all the pumpkin events, beer fests, everything surrounding Oktoberfest, it's really just in full swing right now. A lot of beer dinners and tap takeovers featuring 20 different pumpkins, you know, people doing things like that. A lot of German-themed beer dinners, which is always delicious.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. So, you know, just really working on things like that right now with Weyerbacher. We've had a lot of small batch releases come out recently and coming out in the next week or two. So that's really fun to use at events. So we're going to taste a couple of those tonight. Again, things that are nice to introduce into New Jersey. What else did we have? But yeah, just kind of playing around with the fall seasonals and then some of the one-offs, which get people more excited. This is Weyerbacher season. After September is when we really start to pick up in terms of sales. You know, it's after the summer. We brew a lot of higher alcohol beers, so people are out there. They're really starting to pick up the Merry Monks again, even though it's year-round. Everyone's like, oh, I love this seasonal. I'm like, it's year-round. But yeah, sure, buy it, please. You know, inform them it's year-round. But they're still like, oh, I'm only going to drink in the fall and Christmas. It's like, okay. Or holiday season. So Merry Monks picks up, Blithering Idiot. So everything, you know, Double Simcoe really just starts chucking along. So I like this time of year.
Yeah. They are great fall, Weyerbacher cold weather
good.
Beers.
Yes,
definitely.
Yes. Cold weather beers, absolutely.
You know.
And you could drink a Monken.
You can drink a
Monk.
Yes. Which is a half Merry Monks, half Imperial pumpkin.
Yes.
So a take on.
And 100% delicious.
Yes. I had that before we started recording, and it was amazing.
Yeah, yay. It was very good.
Speaking of that Imperial pumpkin, I saw something you posted on your Facebook that Imperial Pumpkin was featured as one of the 10 best pumpkin beers on the planet from menshealth.com.
Yes.
Which is amazing. Congratulations to
number
you guys.
Two,
number two,
also.
In fact. Yes.
Wow.
So
wow.
Congratulations to you guys.
Thank
indeed.
You. Oh, thank you.
So we have local royalty, more or less, in the beer world for pumpkin, which is really cool. And you guys, there's other beers on there. There's Pumpkin is on there. Rogue is on there and a few others. Mm-hmm. And that's no small achievement. So
no.
Congratulations, guys.
It was really nice. Yeah.
And given the number of pumpkin beers and how it exponentially increases
everybody
every
does
year.
One. Yeah, so, yeah.
Yeah, you go to the liquor store as well in Jersey. You go to the liquor stores in PA. You would be going to the beer distributors and stores and everything. And there's just so many pumpkins every year. I feel like it doubles. So to still be a standout pumpkin, to still have people pick us up year-round, it's really nice. So accolades to the brewer.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So, Christian, what does it smell like in here when you brewed pumpkin back in June?
Yes.
April. As soon as you put those spices in at the end of the boil, it just smelled like pumpkin pie cookies.
Nice.
Oh.
And how hot was it outside?
100 degrees.
Yeah. Sometimes on the brew deck, it would, 110 up there.
Hard to feel that nice crisp fall air when.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think I'd resent those aromas when it was 100 degrees out. I'd be like, seriously?
In the heat of July.
Yeah.
A lot of you guys don't drink the pumpkin, right? You don't like it? Is it?
Brewers.
It's a very good pumpkin beer.
I
do not enjoy the pumpkin ale style.
Okay.
Yeah. A lot of brewers, I think, have a love-hate relationship with pumpkin beers.
Right. I kind of tell everyone when I'm out there, you know, as a joke. I'm like, oh, you know, they brew so much. They go home in the middle of summer. They smell like pumpkin. And they go home and everyone's like, oh, you smell so great. And it's like, shut up. I don't want to smell like a Yankee Candle for 4 months out of the year. So it's like, they don't really love
nice,
our pumpkin.
I will say, when we first pulled up in the lot here, when we first got here and got out of the car, you could smell the spent grain in the air. And it was like, very nice. So you guys brew, like, pretty much almost all the time, right? I mean, you're, like, constantly...
Yeah, I mean, we brew to keep up with demand, so we are out of pumpkin season, but things, you know, we thought we'd get a little slow down, but now we have to prepare for winter ale, we have to make quad.
Winter is coming.
Winter is coming.
We have to brew more Blithering Idiot, and Blithering Idiot also for Insanity, because that needs to be aged in barrels for, when does that come out? January?
January.
Yeah.
Yes. And then Tiny, I mean, again, everything really starts to pick up too. The bigger beers, which take yep. more time for you guys.
Yep.
You know, double mashing. Or
a triple mashing.
Triple for Tiny and Blithering Idiot. Triple yeah. mashing.
Yeah.
So, you know, two beers that, fruit fly in the beer. you know, two beers that take a lot of time for you guys, just really trying yeah. to keep up with that schedule.
Yeah, and we also have our Brewer Reserve beers. We got one of them coming out. We're brewing one of them pretty soon.
Cassiopeia.
Mm-hmm. Tango's coming up.
Yes. Reserva should be out soon.
Reserva will be out pretty soon. Yeah.
Are you ever going to brew Sour Black again?
I don't know.
It's so good. It's like my favorite beer ever.
We have something
called... You should have told me. I have a couple bottles at home.
Yeah. Well, apparently there's some bottles over there, but you can't
get them. We couldn't reach them.
They're locked away.
Steph's pointing at Dan Werbach's hidden cellar in the back left corner.
Oh.
No one can squeeze through to
That's
get
private
to
reserve.
Mm-hmm. That's why the cases are packed in there so tightly somebody. By Brandon. Yeah. Yes.
I still say if we had a grappling hook, we could have gone up over.
Yeah.
We could have made it.
We could have
Batman Austin that was shit. Here. Actually, any of you guys can really monkey over those cases and mm-hmm. kegs yeah. pretty easily.
Now it's
We're
all
pretty
recorded,
nimble around
so
here.
There's proof. Yeah. We can't get away with it.
Yeah.
We didn't take anything.
We didn't really try. We didn't put much effort into it.
By the
we
time
didn't.
This airs, it'll already be long gone. And it'll...
If there's anything missing, Natalie took it.
Yeah. That was all her idea.
Yes, it was my idea, but I can't climb over those, so I cannot say I actually got my hands on it to take it. Mm-hmm. I do have a couple sours out there.
Yeah, I'm not sure what's being released where for Pariah, mm-hmm. but I think that, what was that, Merry Monks? That was...
Merry Monks in oak barrels
in
with...
oak barrels with Brett and Lecto.
Was there fruit in that one or no?
No.
Okay. Was that into that GABF?
I believe so, yeah.
Yes.
Yay.
Yes.
Are you both going?
No, neither.
Nope.
Oh,
neither of us are going.
No, we're sending out, who's going? Bob, Sean Gary, that's one person. Gary, Bobby.
Bob Fotu, Bobby Clark, Sean Ferrero, Scott Bixler.
Scott, that's right. Okay.
How many beers did you enter this year?
Ooh.
A lot.
All of them.
They had a different system this year. That way everyone could get in and enter their beers into GABF. So before there was always the time frame in the window slot and some people would miss out and not get to enter beers or not to get to showcase. So I think they allowed almost not everyone to enter, but a larger amount and then based it mm-hmm. off of how many people entered, how many beers you got to enter, how many breweries signed up, and then they determined how many beers each brewery
Something
could enter.
Complicated so. Algorithm.
Yes, but it actually makes more sense because right. even if you can only enter four, at least you got to enter four to be judged as opposed to if you just missed
the
2 hour.
Cutoff
right.
and somebody else has 10 or whatever.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. So I don't know.
Several.
Numerous.
We'll say several.
Numerous.
Probably more than 2 and less than 12.
Definitely less than 12.
Definitely
okay,
less
there
than
we go.
The cutoff used to be 8, I think. When
yeah.
you, so.
I think it was 8, yeah. yeah.
So less more than 2, less than 8.
Yes.
Somewhere around there. All right.
Probably Pariah, Monks, Tiny, Reserva. Pumpkin usually goes in. Tart Nouveau, I know, went in.
Tart Nouveau went in.